All right, so today we're back with the IMs. We have one more after today, two more including today. Today will be John 15, starting at verse 1. This is Jesus saying that I am the true vine. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. And as normal, we'll kind of look at maybe the more of the typical way of looking at it, and then maybe take a little more of a contemplative look at it. Jesus is the vine. We are the branches. If we come to Jesus, we attach to him, and then we are to go out and make disciples and bear fruit. And if we don't bear fruit, we get cut off and we get thrown in hell and we're burned forever and ever and ever. If we bear good fruit, then God will come along from time to time and prune us up so we can grow more fruit. And then the kingdom continues to grow and our churches grow and we end up being megachurch pastors and we make a lot of money and we have huge success. And that's the vine. And Jesus is the true vine that makes all that possible. If only ever so. Verse 1, chapter 15, Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, so that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. So neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up, and they gather them and they cast them into the fire and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit. And so prove to be my disciples. Just as the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you so that my joy may be in you. And that your joy may be made full. So one of the first words that really jumped out at me as I was reading through that was the word abide. And I realized I didn't really know what that word meant. Does anybody know what the word abide means? Or when you hear the word abide, like, what do you think? Like, what does that mean? Abide in me. Stay by me. Okay. Agree with me. Okay. Believe in me. Remain in me. So stay, remain. So once again, Jesus isn't saying, come to me. He's saying, remain in me. And you remain in me, and I remain in you. So once again, this isn't about conversion. This isn't about conforming to something because we already are. This is about transforming. So I look at this yucca cane right here. This is a yucca cane. And this yucca cane was growing and it had one stalk. But then, what do they call the people who work at nurseries? Do they have a title? Arborist? Nursery worker? Arborist sounds right. I'll go. Well, this yucca cane's a tree. Gardener? Somebody who worked for a nurse. So what they did is they cut this off. They cut it off, right? And now there are five different yucca canes growing out of the one. So they pruned it so that way it could bear more fruit, right? And so you remain in me. Why? So that way we can bear more fruit. I'm going to prune. There's some things that are going to fall away from time to time, but the word abide really was messing with me because it was like, come to me, come to me. No, he's saying, stay in me, and I in you. Because if you exist, we've talked about this before, if you are held together, you are in me. Because in Christ, all things held together. So if you're outside of Christ, you don't exist. You are not held together. The molecules and cells and atoms of your body are no longer bound, and there's nothing outside of Christ. And he says, stay or remain in me, and I remain in you. So if I am in Christ, and if I exist, that means I'm in Christ, and therefore Christ is also in me. So Jesus, once again, is not asking for our conversion. He's not asking for our conformity. He's asking for transformation. Just like the yucca cane was transformed from one to five. And so there's a lot that really jumped out in here with me. And so if we are just living our lives and we are in Christ and we're not really bearing fruit, and we'll get into what that moment, because I really want to, I don't know, what does that even mean? Bearing fruit. What does that mean? I don't know what that means. I have to think about that. I'll write that part of the sermon in a minute. But that idea of, if I'm going through my life and I'm in Christ, because Jesus is, we'll call this the vine, right? And all these branches, they're able to exist because they're in the vine. But if I'm not really aware of that position, and I'm not really allowing myself to be pruned when necessary, eventually the branch dries up and falls off. I was, for the last couple of weeks I've been trying to mow the lawn here. It doesn't go very well because, you know, you can't go more than 4 hours without a downpour of rain. But the main thing is that when I'm, you know, after the winter, the yard, and I'm sure Steve can attest to this, there's branches everywhere. Like, before you can do anything, you got to go and pick up all the branches that fell down in the winter. Why? Because they weren't really doing anything. They were being outshone by the branches that were bigger and better and had been pruned, maybe, and so they were drying and they were just falling off. And then what do? I go through the field and I collect them all up and then I take them back to the fire pit, and then eventually sometime in the summer when it's not too dry but not too wet, because I almost caught the woods on fire one time, so I don't do that anymore. And I burn them up, right? And I set them on fire. Now, what happens when they're burned up? What happens when they're set on fire? Right? They literally, the molecules in the cells that hold them together go away, and the branches cease to exist because they were no longer useful. They lost the purpose. They lost the life that they had. And so another part of this was the pruning. Now, a few weeks ago, you guys met Jeff, Pastor Jeff, who was here, and hopefully he'll come back. One of the things that, the first time I met him, he said, if 5 years ago you doesn't look at current you and see a heretic, you might be doing something wrong. And I said, what do you mean by that? He says, every once in a while, God has to come by and prune up the branches. And if you're not allowing God to prune up and cut off what is no longer necessary, there's no more room for you to grow. Right? And so I began to think, and so I always talked about this, and you guys remember way back, I talked about the wall and the bubble, right? And so we looked at the wall, this wall that we had been, that had been constructed for us. A lot of us, the wall was constructed for us because we weren't really given a choice. We were, you know, we had to go to Sunday school every Sunday as kids, and we went to church every Sunday as kids, and we were told what to believe. We weren't allowed to question it. We weren't allowed to doubt. And if you asked the pastor questions, you know, you weren't welcome there anymore. And so we have this wall that has been constructed. And so Richard Rohr, who you guys should be familiar with, I talk about a lot. One of the things he says is the problem with the conservative is that they spend all their time in construction. And any time one of the bricks gets challenged in their wall, they have to construct the wall higher to protect that brick, because they refuse to let any brick or any piece of what they believe to be true to be challenged or questioned. And so they're constantly constructing this wall. And he says the problem with the liberal is all they ever want to do is just deconstruct everything. We just want to tear everything down, and we want to come through, and this book's no good, and this brick's no good, and just rip it all to the part, rip it all apart. And what he said, he says, what the mystic does is the mystic allows God to come in from time to time and remove bricks that are no longer necessary, so you can replace them with new bricks. And this is a process we call reconstruction. And this is where we want to stay. This is pruning our faith. This is pruning what we believe to be true. And so we're the branch and we're connected to the vine. And as we grow, there's certain things at certain times in our faith that we need, that are important to us and that are necessary for our growth and our development at that particular time in our faith. But as we mature and as the progress of revelation takes place in our life, those who understand progressive revelation, Jesus talks about progressive revelation all the time. As things progress, other elements that are no longer necessary begin to die away. They get pruned off. And so we want to be open to God's pruning. We want to allow Him to come into our life from time to time and prune off the stuff that is no longer necessary. And I spent the last 3 years just blurting all that stuff out. This is no longer necessary. That's wonderful. It's no longer necessary to me, but it might still be necessary for you. And one of my biggest frustrations over the last couple of years is that you guys won't let me prune your branches. But then I realized it's not my job to prune your branches. Maybe your branches don't need pruning like mine did. God's going to prune your branches when He's ready to prune your branches, and when and if you're ever willing to let Him. Right? And I'm not saying you're not, and I'm saying He's trying and you won't let Him. Right? But from time to time, we need to allow our branches to be pruned. We need to be able to look at, what do I believe? This is one of the questions I ask. I ask people this question all the time. Who is God? You know the most common answer I get when I say, who is God? Anyone, just take a poll. So I ask 10 people, who is God? What is the most common answer I get? The Creator? Howard? Not Howard. Have you ever seen this video? Karen sent me this video this morning. This guy, he thought God's name was Howard because our Father, Lord in heaven, Howard be your name. So God's not Howard, but Creator. Okay, so we have Creator. What's some of the most common answer I get when I ask, and once again, I'm asking Christian people, who is God? Creator, any other thoughts that we might get? Father? Okay, that's a good answer. Anybody else have any things that I might get? What? Love? The Almighty? The most common answer I get when I ask people who is God is, I don't know. I don't know. Yeah! Who is God? I don't know. Woo! Right? Because how much do we spend really thinking about who God is, right? And when we do, we have these adjectives, but that's not telling me who God is, that's telling me about God. God is the Creator, but who is He? In His being, in His core being, who is God, right? And sometimes, you know, we think of Him as, you know, the Punisher. Sometimes we think of Him in different terms, depending on where we're at, right? But who is He? Who are you? Right? And once again, those are two questions that sound very simple to ask, but most people can't answer them. Who are you? Well, I don't know. Yeah. Most of the time they'll give me their name. That's not who you are. That's just your name. They'll give me their profession. That's not who you are. That's what you do to make money. Who are you? I don't know. What? There you go. I think you and I have had that conversation before. You cheated. And so, if we recognize our position, that no matter where we go, no matter what we do, we've decided that I'm going to remain in Christ. And I'm going to allow Him to be the source. He's going to suck up the water out of the soil. And then as the water comes up the vine, He's going to release it out into the branches. He's going to take the nutrients out of the soil that He gets out of the water, and they're going to come up into the vine, and He's going to release them out into the... Everything that I need for my survival, I'm going to get from Him. because He is the source of everything. He is the vine. That's who He is. And then who am I? I'm an offshoot of Him. I'm an offshoot of Him. I am His presence in the world. Why? Because I am in Him and He is in me. And so where I go, He goes. Where I go, His presence goes. And from time to time, there are going to be things that I'm taking out into the world that are no longer necessary. And God's going to come along and God's going to say, all right, it's time to give you a little trim, 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 and trim things up. And then, you know, they begin to get bigger and bigger. Now, this isn't meaning our churches are going to get bigger. It doesn't mean our family is going to get bigger. What's going to get bigger? The way people look at me. God's presence in me. God's love in me. People are going to see it bigger. When they look at me, they're going to see His presence. They're going to see His love. They're going to feel His grace. Because I'm allowing it to abide in me. I'm not wasting it. I'm not throwing it into the fire to be burned up and to cease to exist. I'm letting Him abide in me. Just as I abide in Him. And the more He abides in me, the more He's there, the more I allow transformation to take place. Therefore, I urge you, brother, Romans 12. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. By the renewing of your mind. It doesn't mean make your mind new. It says transformation is a process that renews your mind. It takes what you know and it redoes it. It prunes it. Transformation is about allowing those things that we think we know. Right? We think we know. But do we really know? Or do we just believe what we've been told? And because we believe the source that we were told, we hold it as credible, and now I know because I heard it from a credible source, or a source that I have deemed credible. Or are we allowing God to prune? Are we allowing God to transform our mind? Are we allowing Him to sustain our life? How many of us are solely dependent upon God for our survival? Right? Once again, right? Because our hands don't go up because we're not. We're dependent upon our jobs. Now we can say, well, God gave me my job, and God provided the food, but many of us, we go out and we do these things. And I'm not saying we just quit our jobs and sit in the house all day waiting for God to magically put money in our banks and food. That's the extreme we're not going to, right? But what are we looking at here? We're looking at allowing Him to be the source, allowing Him to be the vine, allowing Him to be the sustainer and the giver of our life. And what is our job? To remain in Him. And when the time is right, we allow God to come in and renew our minds. We allow God to come in and prune, get rid of the things that we no longer need to believe. Because the angry God that I talk so much about is necessary. We need the angry God model. Because there are certain points in time in people's lives when they need the threat. They need the fear of discipline and punishment and anger if they mess up to keep them on the straight and narrow. That's not a bad model of God, but as we grow, we need to grow up out of that. And once again, I never believed in an angry God. Okay, that's fine. But the logical conclusion of a lot of the gods that we believed in was an angry God. We just don't say it that way. Because nobody in the history of the world has gotten up and said, I believe God is angry and wrathful and going to kill everybody. We don't say it. But the logical conclusion of our theology is that. Right? And that model, once again, is necessary for people who are in infancy. Right? Paul talks about this, and Paul says that there is a point in time when you need breast milk. Right? And a lot of us live our entire lives just on breast milk. We never mature. We never grow to enjoy solid food. Right? This is once again the progress of revelation. Okay, we want to let some of those things that we needed as infants to go away as we grow into adults. This is the pruning. This is the renewing of our mind. This is transformation. I'm wanting to be transformed into the image of the vine. I want to begin to look like the vine, because as the branch grows and as the branch gets pruned, other branches begin to come off of that. Right? But the source goes through me into him. See, he's still the source. We want to grow new branches. We want our minds to be renewed. We want our minds to be transformed. We want to let him come in and prune us up from time to time, so that way we will remain in him. Because the objective is not to come to Christ. The objective is to remain in Christ.